أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا ونبينا طبيبنا وحبيب الله رب العالمين أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد وعليه الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين سيما بقية الله العظام بقية الله خير لكم إن كنتم مؤمنين ولعنة الدائم على أعدائهم وغاصب حقوقهم ومنكري فضائلهم أجمعين من الآن إلى قيام يوم الدين أما بعد فقد أبا عبد الله الحسين عليه السلام بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم أثني على الله أحسن الثناء وأحمده على السراء والضراء اللهم إني أحمدك على أن أكرمتنا بالنبوة وجعلت لنا أسماء وأبصارا وأفئدة وعلمتنا القرآن ووفقتنا في الدين فجعلنا لك من الشاكرين صلاة على محمد وآل محمد
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد
Final light of the discussion of this sermon of Abu Abdullah al-Hussein, very similar to this evening, which is the ninth evening. Similarly, we prayed. Similarly, we are discussing that very sermon which was delivered by Abu Abdullah. But there's a lot of difference here. The greatest of all is indeed that hour where women and children were surrounded by the enemies. And the Imam is fully aware that all of them will be shaheed, all of them will be martyred tomorrow. But at the same time, that sort of eloquency, that sort of peace of mind and peace of heart that the man had, that he could really praise Allah, he could really thank Allah, he could really ask Allah that he be from those who are the thanksgiven, the shakirin, those who could really thank. No, you and I cannot really imagine in what state he was at. And when we reflect upon his words, upon the meaning or the deeper meaning on the basis of the traditions from the Masumeen, because who are we to really understand the depth of his word, of his sermon? It is really those traditions, those riwayat that could really become a key to unlock the secrets of the speech of Abu Abdullah al-Hussein. To really understand what is the difference between thana, what is the difference between hamd and shukr. For us it's all thanks, for us is really, we cannot really comprehend. We discuss issues in regards to tawheed, alhamdulillah. Then we talked about nabuwat itself and the importance of the Quran, where the Imam is pointing out to that. And another thing which he talks about is tafakkuh, which he talks about is wawaffaqtana in the acquiring or in the understanding of deen, of religion, which is very important. Perhaps we'll focus a bit on that, and then the issue or the reality of shakirin. See, gaining knowledge in regards to deen has been overly emphasized by our imams. They would dedicate the Friday in which they will teach their children, in which they will teach their companions particularly, and they would ask their companions that Friday should be the day where you should teach your kids about Islam, about deen. So one day they would dedicate for teaching about Islam. And this is something to really bring about into our lives. Now we should really practice this. Issues related to ahkam, issues related to Quran, issues related to aqaid, these should be discussed by parents, by senior members of the community with the young ones. One have to dedicate that. And if you look at the general overall picture of the development of Shia school, how Shias, they survived after Imam Hussain alayhi salam and the Imams who lived, or after the occultation as well, you find the same methodology being in practice. Scholars, ulama, seniors, members of the community, they would save and secure the hadith and traditions, and they would transfer that to the generations after generation. They will dedicate themselves to the gatherings in which they would discuss issues in regards to deen. And alhamdulillah, this has become part and parcel of our culture, of our practices. You know, the majalis of Abu Abdullah Hussain alayhi salam is serving that very purpose, and it is very much required. And that's what we've mentioned in the very beginning, that the majalis must have that element of educating, not just emotional aspect, that is also necessary, that should be there, but at the same time it should have that educational aspect. It's very important. And the development of the formation of the school of marjaiyat, if you look at it, it is for that very purpose that the scholars in the beginning, they were the ashab who used to live far away in different countries, in different places, spread around the parts of the Islamic empire, if you want to call, or the Islamic world. And on the basis of what they had, they would guide people. And today we tend to see very similar to what during the times of the Imam occurred. You know, we are not far from the practices of the Mumineen who lived during the times of the Imam. Many a times when the representatives of the Imam living in Morocco, living in Yemen, when they would write to the Imam asking issues in regards to ahkam, the Imam would say that, don't you have those traditions and riwayat that existed from sixth Imam, for example? They would say, yes, we do. And the Imams would say, on those basis, give them the verdict, give them the answer. So today as well, when it comes to that institution or institutionalization of the system of the marjaiyat, is that very fact that the maraje are the representative of that body, which is the Ahl Bayt. And on those basis, they attend to the needs, to the religious needs, to the social needs, to the cultural needs of the community. And whether that be during the time of Bani Umayyah, whether that be during the time of Abbasis, whether that be during the time of the Ottomans, they have always tried to undermine the authority of these figures who were well versed in the Quran and well versed in the hadith of Masumin alayhim salam. They have always created that conflict, and while doing so, they never realized that dedication of the Mumineen that existed in every period. And when the Ayatollah, who is known as Tambaku-e Shirazi, when he gives that verdict of prohibiting the tobacco because of what though the tobacco industry was being utilized as a medium to transfer arms from the Western countries, where he passes that verdict, after that, when it was prohibited in the Muslim or in the Shia land, he said that I have made an error, so to speak, where I have made them realize the power that the marjaiyat have because of that verdict. Now the West knows that how strong this position of marjaiyat is, because it was banned, it was prohibited. You know, the plans which they had was foiled and failed because of just one fatwa. So therefore, in every era, the forces who have realized the haq and truth and the success of the school of Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam have undermined. Ahlul Bayt themselves, when they were alive, or after that, their traditions, their riwayat and the Quran. So today as well, something that we see of this accord, in order to break our communities, in order to break that system of marja'iyat, many different ways are used. You know, as Imam had mentioned, you know, Shah, when he made an error, you know, Yazid made an error, and that was, he tried to crush the commemoration of the majalis of Abu Abdullah al-Husayn alayhi salam, and he was toppled. He was uprooted. That's what he did. And that's what happened. You know, the Qiyam of Tawabi'in, the Umayyad dynasty was lost. And the same thing continued with the Abbasi. They tried to do the same thing. They vanished. They disappeared. The Ottomans, if you say, the same thing. And the Shah, as you know, the history, that whoever will do majlis or rozekhani or those plays that they used to have, you know, they will arrest them, they will prison them, they will, you know, have banned the majalis of Imam Hussain alayhi salam. And this really toppled them. So now the state of the affair is so that the majalis are not banned, but within the majalis, certain elements are created through which the power of the message of Imam Hussein is undermined. Because they have realized that if we directly attack majalis, if we directly stop the procession of Imam Hussein, if we directly destroy them, it's not going to work that way. As we see that, you know, what Saddam tried to do, and today what we see in regards to what's happening in Karbala. You know, 6 million, 7 million more Zawar, right? So now there is internal creation of dispute and disunity among the school by critical approaches on the basis of maybe politics or on the basis of maybe intellectual academics. They are trying to undermine this. So this is something that one have to realize, that that tafaqquh, that understanding of deen, is very important. And this has always been there, as we said. And the truth lies in the hands of those who have that ability to really extract that, to really, you know, do that ijtihad, which is nothing but the methodology been given by the Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam. So now the Imam on that day is pointing it to that. So you see, when we talked a little bit of Ghadir, we did an ishara, we did an indication. The day of Ghadir was really the day of freedom, where, as Imam Hussain alayhi salam points out to that, the Qiyam of Imam Hussain alayhi salam, the uprising of Imam Hussain alayhi salam, is for freedom. Deen has been in prison through the so-called Khalifas, which they call themselves. But by the sacrifice of Imam Hussein, by the Qiyam of Imam Hussein, he is leaving behind that legacy of free deen. A religion that is free. A man is free in the deen. If we compare the school of Imam Hussein alayhi salam, the school of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, to that school which call itself as Islam, where all that sort of activity which they carry out, how fundamental, how extremist they are. Why? Because deen says so. That's their approach in regards to deen. But the approach of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam is the approach where the value of humanity, the value of freedom exists. So the Qiyam of Imam Hussein, the uprising of Imam Hussein, the declaration of Ghadir is really for the freedom of man, where deen will not be utilize for their desires, for their purposes. And that's what they did. And that's what they are doing today as well. They are using the name of Deen for whatever they want to do. They are the Khuddam of Haramain Sharifain. They are the, you know, Mujtahideen or Maraje or whatever, you know, in terms of their word is the word of Quran, for example. You know, whatever the fatwa gives. And they act upon it to the extent that they do not even realize that what they are saying is really ajeeb in terms of, you know, the fatwa in regards to, which is on circulated, where the women, they could go and serve those who are fighting in Syria, and it is the woman's jihad to really be the jawari, to really be the sex slave of those who are fighting. This is the fatwa. And they follow it. This is what? This is nothing but chaining the human beings, not allowing them to think, contemplate, and understand. But when it comes to the deen of Masumeen, we find there's a great deal of research where the human value is so unique and special, where they allow you to really think. So therefore, tafakkur, understanding the deen, is that important. That Imam Hussain reminded on that day, that do not be just blind followers. Have that knowledge of that deen, that insight of the deen. And Imam is really thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he and his household has provided that. And we are proud once again to really point that out in our canons of that marjayat, that freedom exists. And having said that, if you look at the gradual development of our deen, whether that be during the times of the Imams or after, let's look at the period after, where you have that importance of the Quran and the traditions by the Mumineen, and they followed it sincerely, and that gradual development of the marjaiyat, the institutionalization of that which was necessary and required in order that deen be protected, in order that tafakkur existed. And then after that is that invention, or after that development, I would say, of the thought of the leadership or the guardian Salatu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. The leadership of the faqih, of the jurist, which was developed, that thought, which is clearly pointing out to that gradual development of that Shia school. And the time was right to be introduced and implemented at that time. However, it was principally discussed by Sheikh Ansari in 1600, 400 years ago, or during the time of the Imams. On that basis it was discussed. So therefore, every era had that unique aspect of tafakkur, of that understanding of deen, and when it is required to really bring that out and implement it, and bring it to the surface of the people where they could utilize, use, and at the same time have that form, to their deen, to their religion. And this is where we have reached. So that's what tafakkur is. That's what a complete good understanding means. Now, as we move along to that last bit, which is the Imam is pointing out to, فَجَعَلْنَا لَكَ مِنَ الشَّاكِرِينَ. So in this little sermon, you have that spiritual, in-depth spiritual aspect of it, and you have that practical aspect of it. The Zahir and at the same time the Batin. And both are very important. And Imam has pointed out in this sermon. And finally, he talks about Shukr. And as we said last night, there's a Shukr which is a Shukr-e Qalbi, where a person with his heart completely realizes that he has to, and he is nothing, but whatsoever he has is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he thanked by his heart, by his presence. Then we pointed out to, in regards to the shukr-e lafzi, where he has to mention it, in terms of zikr and askar or different forms of ibadat, that he really thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for what has been provided to him. Then we said there is an amali aspect of the shukr, which is where a person is, on the basis of the hadith, acts upon the things which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have commanded him, which is halal, and he acts upon it, the wajibat, and he refrains from those things which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have prohibited for him. That is called a shukr, that's called a thanksgiving, however, in a form of action. So these are three different levels of shukr. And the haqiqat, or the essential aspect of that shukr, is reaching to that ultimate level where one realizes that he is nothing. When Musa alayhi salam was asked by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, "Oh Musa, you know, fulfill the responsibility of thanksgiving to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala." Then he replied that, "How can I do so? Because my thanksgiving, my saying Alhamdulillah, my saying Shukranillah itself requires another shukr. Because even me thanking Allah, you know, it's an opportunity that is given to me, that those, you know, organs has been given to me, the realization have been given to me, that I regard you as the one who is my Lord. This itself requires a shukr." Then Allah replied, "Now you have fulfilled the responsibility of true thanksgiving, of real shukr, what really shukr means. Because in that state, that person, that waliullah, that nabi is not regarding him as anything. You know, he has reached to that point. So that is the essential aspect of shukr. Now, the effects of a person who really who give thanks, what are the asarat, what are the ta'sirat? You know, traditions points out to, such as the most famous of them is la in shakartum la zidannakum. The more you thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the more Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will increase in that ni'mat that has been provided to you. Now, when I'm thanking Allah, if I have that in mind in terms of lafzi, qalbi and amali, so I have to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in regards to my deen in all three aspects. Not just I say, "Oh, thank you, I'm a believer of the school of Ahlul Bayt and I do nothing." They have to be amali aspect, they have to be qalbi aspect as well. You know, so if I am carrying it out, the effect of it is that I will be increased in my understanding of the maqamat of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, who they are and what they are. You know, I will be the one who will be the close to the school of Ahlul Bayt, to the imams of the time. And then it will automatically affect my understanding of true thanksgiving. You know, it's all related to each other. You know, it's like a thread in that carpet. If you pull that one thread, it will affect the whole carpet. You know, that thread has to be there. So it, and that's how the sciences of Islam is. You know, Islam and what has been prescribed in Islam is like everything is related to each other, is interconnected to each other. So if I am giving thanks to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then obviously Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will increase in my ni'mat. Then in another hadith it says that it is the protection of ni'mat itself. If I'm thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for what has been given to me, while giving thanks, I'm ensuring that ni'mat that is provided to me. You see, it has that effect as well. So when I thank for my deen, I'm protecting my deen. If I thank for my children, I'm protecting my children. If I'm thank for the maal, position, whatsoever have been given, and it is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I am ensuring that, I am protecting that at the same time. Then it says, it will provide you a state of self-sufficiency, self-reliance. You know, you will have that qina'at, which is one of the ahsan or good qualities of the nafs, that he should be self-sufficient. You know, he should be, because he comes in that state of Shakir, you know, he is thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whether that be sarrai or dharrai. So he becomes self-sufficient. You know, he is not affected or impacted by anything that he doesn't have. He will not fall for it. He will not go towards it because he doesn't have. As he doesn't have, he doesn't feel that, you know, that, you know, that is anything that he's missing as such, because he has reached that position, that maqam of self-sufficiency. And how has he reached that? It is through thanksgiving. It's through thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as a matter of fact, you know, as we have that age of youth, that being young, you know, it's one of the greatest ni'mat that Allah provides. As Hazrat Amir says in one of the hadiths, that there are two things that a man is ghafil, is forgetful of. There are two things that a man is forgetful of, two ni'mat that a man is forgetful of. One is his health. That when he is healthy, he is forgetful. You know, he doesn't realize there is such thing as health. The other is the youth. You know, when he is young, you know, he would realize after getting old that he was young. And in another hadith, the Imam says in regards to that young age, to that youth, that is, he compares to the Anbiya. He says that how Anbiya are compared to regular lay men, in the same way a young lad, a youthfulness, or the youth, the, you know, the reality of youth is compared to that Nabi, compared to other lay people. So that young age is really one of the greatest ni'mat that one have to utilize. And the Imam says that if a person is young and he doesn't dedicate himself to educate himself, tafakkur, to educate himself in deen, and if he comes to me, I will be one that I will do ta'adib, you know, I will sort of attend to him, you know, I will kind of punish him. And he says that if he is young, in another hadith, if he is young and he doesn't dedicate to educate himself in regards to Islam, in regards to deen, if he doesn't dedicate himself to educate himself in regards to deen, he has wasted his time. As he has wasted his time, he has committed a sin. As he has committed a sin, he is liable of being punished. So a person who is young, he should be very, you know, we are old now. Now we have young people here, mashallah, you know, that they have that opportunity to really utilize that time instead of really spending that time, because time just goes just like that. If you sit on an internet, although you might be doing reading news, 10 newspapers one after the other, 45 minutes, hour and a half just gone like that. Then you realize, oh, the break time is over, or I have to do this, or I have to do that. You know, I am sort of falling behind in many things. Why? Because all of the time that I have spent is, you know, trying to find out what news existed. One victory of, I don't know, you know, San Francisco Giants happened, but there are 10 articles in regards to that I have to read, because I'm really a fan of San Francisco Giants. You know, they will talk about different players and what they have done, and I have to know every what new different channels how they have praised or what they have talked about. It's very unique. You know, it's all, you know, very knowledgeable and very good. It's really, you know, I'm pulled towards that. But all of a sudden I realize that it's just, I wasted so much of time. And then I realize, oh, I'm falling behind in other things which I have to do, which are my responsibility. You know, I have to prepare for my class, I have to write the essay, I have to do my, you know, laundry, I have to do this and that, which I cannot really overlook these things. And those are very important. If I don't do that, I will not function. Then I will cut short, or I will not attend the majlis, or I will just quickly pray, or I will just, you know, not focus on deen. You know, it's the deen that suffers is mazloom, really. Whether that be from a person who is young, or whether that be the person who is old. Whether that be in the sense that he is doing zulm on deen, or in a group, everybody blames the deen at the end of the day. It's very unfortunate. So therefore, this young age, that youth, is very important. And at that time, if one really trains and tames oneself and bring about good qualities in him, then that will be with him and it will help him, and it will be like a support and light for him when he gets old. You know, after 40 is really downhill. You know, Bismillah, Aghai Mirza. After 40 is downhill, that's it, it's finished. But before that, for those who haven't reached, you know, there is still time. you know, inshallah. And also, mashallah, with the dedication that our seniors have, our elders have, and their presence here itself shows that they've been sincere and there is something that really brought them here. And that love really creates that revolution. Really brings, you know, as it says, Asra bi abdihi layl, in one night, you know, a prophet was taken. So for those who are old as well, those who are seniors as well, they should not lose hope that, oh, it's over now. No, it's not the case. But the point is, particularly the message is for the young and for the youth, that they should realize this ni'mat of young age, of youthfulness that they have in them, and they should, you know, cash in. They should really achieve the fruit of it. And they have that ability and capacity to do so. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. So the reality of shukr is that where one says that وَمَا بِكُم مِّن نِعْمَةٍ فَمِنَ اللَّهِ. Whatsoever ni'mat, whatsoever bounty that is there, been given to me, it is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He recognizes that. And then we pointed out to the different aspects of the shukr or the effects of the shukr. And on the other hand, on the contrary, if a person doesn't thank, then you have la azabun shadid. La in kafartum, you know, and fa in kafartum la azab shadid. You know, he will face the greatest of azab, you know, and he will be in a state of necessity and need all the time, because Allah is not increasing. Allah will increase if I thank. And on the other hand, if he's not thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah will refrain or restrain that ni'mat from him. So that's the second thing. One is azab in itself. The other is that, you know, that sort of, that need, that limitation will exist for him. The other thing that he will face is that he will have no desire for doing good. You know, if he is not thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to others, he will not have that desire of doing any good. That will automatically be taken away from him. The fourth thing is, which is one of the azab, which our sixth imam have mentioned, is the pressing of the grave, which is the fishari qabr. That if he doesn't thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he will be mubtala, or he will face a punishment, that is the pressing of the grave. Salat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. And we have seen that how the imams have pointed out to in regards to thanks. You know, there are many examples, such as when that camel was lost. When that camel was lost of the sixth imam, an imam says, if I get that, I will fulfill the full responsibility of thanking you, Allah. And finally, they brought the camel. So he says, Alhamdulillah. So everybody says, that's it. You know, they thought that, you know, giving thanks means that Imam gonna slaughter that 10 camels or do this or that. We tend to depict or think that way, that what thanksgiving really mean as, oh, it means that you really have to do something, you have to lift the mountain or something. No, Imam said, Alhamdulillah. Then he said, is that it? He said, yes, that's what it is. It's Alhamdulillah. Why is that? On what position he's thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that is different. Because he is on a position or on a level where he is seeing nothing whatsoever is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that Alhamdulillah has a different weight than me just saying Alhamdulillah. You know, we who are on a lower level tend to do many different things. You know, tend to do the niyat that we'll do 100 tasbih of, you know, dedicated or to this or that, you know, if our vow is fulfilled. Or we'll thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we'll recite 100 rakat of shukrana, for example. But if a person reaches on that level of spirituality and perfection, where he sees nothing but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whether that be he in a state of pain, whether that be he in a state of joy, it is from Allah. So if it's given to him, you know, it says, you know, he says Alhamdulillah. And we will also now say Alhamdulillah if our sisters are quiet, inshallah, with a loud salawat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Another salawat for our sisters here. Finally, in order to wrap the whole discussion on this sermon and, you know, to pay its dues towards shukr, the scholars have pointed out to that how the shukr should be given. One of them, they say that ahsan al-shukr, the best of shukr, is the one that ni'mat reaches to others. If ni'mat is given to me, the best of thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is this ni'mat that is given to me must reach others. If I have been given knowledge, if I have been given, you know, education, if I have been given mal, if I have been given, you know, ability to serve the community, dedicate the time, if I have been given the time, all of these things, the best of thanksgiving is the one that I utilize this skill, this ni'mat, in order that it reaches others as well. I spread others as well. You know, as they say that the zakat of ilm is that you give to others. You know, that is the zakat, that is the charity. So the same way this ni'mat that is given to me is should be dedicated to others. You know, if I'm been given a skill, for example, this very quickly. Number two, the way to thank him is to really love that medium through which he has got the ni'mat. If life is given to us through our parents, we have to really love our parents because this ni'mat of life is from them. Our teacher have given us something. If our neighbor have given us something, if our friend, if our brother, if our sister have any ni'mat, you know, don't just think that ni'mat is in the form of mal. It could be even that time that he sits with you. It could be even that tea that she provides you, that water that the little child brings for you. So in return, you have to love that medium, that individual who is providing that. And that's where we can understand the greatest of ni'mat is really the ni'mat of the wilayat of Ahl Bayt alayhi salam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. And our love to the masumeen through this wilayat where we reach that ultimate purpose of or the goal of being a human being, you know, is through them. And that love comes there, you know, sits there. And you can fit that same principle, I'm really discussing on the principle level, you can fit this on many different examples, you know, that one could find. The other thing is focusing the way to thank, focusing upon the despair or the difficulties that others are facing while thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is not in the sense that, oh, I'm having good time, but they are having, na'uzubillah, bad time. Not in that sense. But rather I will realize that how much people are suffering just to have a gathering like this. You know how dangerous it is to have a gathering like this that we are having here in Iraq or in Pakistan or in Bahrain or in Saudi Arabia. But we are having that. We really have to compare this to those people who are suffering. When we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we have to realize that. You know, that's one of the ways. That's how we should really thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for. You know, and all other aspects, whether that be mal, education, parents, family, children, you know, difficulties we are facing, but at the same time to the difficulties what the people, what the lovers of Ahl Bayt are facing in Syria, what those refugees are facing, for example, who've been kicked out of their land. They are in the camps. There's no heating system as such, but at least we do have here. So that really requires that thank. One must really compare to what the despair and the difficulties that the people are in. And while giving thanks, see the beauty of it is really points out to there. While I do that, while I thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I pray for them as well. I realize their difficulties as well, their problems as well, their mushkilat as well, while I'm doing that. So that is a true thanksgiving, you know. You know, as we are approaching really Thanksgiving, you know, a lot of Thanksgiving we are talking about, we think that Thanksgiving is really to have that turkey, you know, have a meal. But rather that there's so much when it comes to the essential aspect of our deen, where is nothing but that shukr itself. the shukr of ni'mah. And here Abu Abdullah al-Husayn alayhi salam is really asking that may he be provided that maqam, you know, that position. Now the question is, although he is on that level, but still it is the eve of Ashura there. You know, it's like one of that la'alla, it's one of that ja'alana, perhaps. You know, maybe, may I be given that opportunity, that this ni'mat of life, this ni'mat of believing in God have been given to me, this ni'mat of nabuwat, this ni'mat of Quran, this ni'mat of understanding deen have been given to me. Tomorrow morning, when I face the enemy, let this ni'mat be sacrificed. Let my actions be that action of shukr. Let my qalb be the qalb of shakir. Let my amal be the amal of shakirin. You know, Imam is asking that from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the eve of Ashura. The eve of Ashura unfolds as the darkness spreads over the horizon. After the Maghribain prayer, this khutbah was very much recited. And then Imam says to his ashab, to his family members, that why don't you take the... And he says in the beginning, he says that my ashab are the best that any of the imams or the prophet had. My companions are the best of companions. My children, my household is the best of household, that they have come along all the way here in this wilderness. See, this is even before their sacrifice, Imam is saying. Even it's before that where Imam says, if you want to go, you can go. No, no, not a problem. You have come until here. I realize that. I appreciate that. And I regard your action in your presence to be the best. And now that it is night, why don't you take the opportunity of night being dark and go to your places? Because these people are thirsty of my blood. They want my blood. If you want to go, you can go ahead. You are free to go. And I will guarantee you that shafaat, that jannat is yours. You have fulfilled your imtihan, your test. You have done it. That's what is required. You are here now. Then there was silence in the camp of Abu Abdullah. Nobody could speak, because after that Imam gives such a strong khutbah and then appreciated them, nobody could really speak. But only the one who breaks that silence is Abul Fazl Abbas. He says, oh my master, what are you saying? Is there Jannat without Hussein? Can it be possible that we enter paradise and we don't have Hussein in that Jannat? There's no paradise, there's no life without you, oh master. And then as Abul Fazl spoke, as he breaks the silence, then the others started paying allegiance to the Imam. Just prior to this also, there's an incident where he puts off the light. So that if you are embarrassed to see me, still I'm putting off the light, why don't you go ahead? Still they did not move an inch. And then one after the other, they pay the vows and allegiance to the Imam. And that really made Imam, that really consoled the Imam. And the night was utilized for ibadat, for zikr. And it's been mentioned that on the ninth night, there was always someone not carrying out any ibadat, but protecting the tent of Imam. He was given the, you know, he was on guard. He was the guard of the tent of the Imam. And the others are all in the indulge, are busy supplicating and praying. But one person wasn't. Some tradition says it was Nafi, or some says it was Burair. And it happened so that on that night, Imam stepped out of the tent in order to examine the battlefield, because every inch and every second, every aspect of the battle of the Imam is well calculated. Even him asking one night to night, in order that they pray, is calculated as well. That Ashura be on the 10th, on that day. So Imam moves forward and at a place he gets down and he starts crying. And here Burair says that I couldn't control myself, that I saw Imam crying, so I move forward. And I asked the Imam, "Oh Imam, why are you crying?" He says, "This is the place where Qasim will fall tomorrow. And this is the place where the body of the Qasim will be under the hooves of the horses." Then he moved forward, then he stops and he started to cry again. Buraira inquires that, "Why are you crying, my Mawla, my master?" He says, "This is the place where that three-headed arrow will tear the neck of Ali Asghar." Then as he moves forward, he cries again. He says, "What is this place, Mawla, my Agha, in that battlefield?" He says that this is that place where that spear will hit the chest of my Ali Akbar. Ali Akbar was known as the closest to the Imam. And he was regarded as very special because he resembled the most to the Prophet. People who wanted to see the Prophet will ask Imam Hussein to bring Ali Akbar. In terms of his speech, in terms of his logic, in terms of his understanding, he reflected no other but the Prophet. And when Ali Akbar comes and seeks the permission to go to the battlefield, Imam gives him that permission. Ali Akbar alayhi salam was prepared, was given that permission to go. And there, as he goes, he senses that someone is following behind. And he looks at, it is the father who is following. And at that time, here, Ali Akbar says, "You are the one who give me the permission to fight." And then finally, Ali Akbar alayhi salam fights a furious battle, and the Imam says that this is that place where that spear will be hit in the chest of Ali Akbar alayhi salam. And here, as he moves forward, there wasn't any place where he talks about the Shahadat of Abul Fazl Abbas. Indeed, the Shahadat of Abul Fazl is also unique, as he died near the Euphrates, as he was asked to bring the water for the children of Hussein. As he goes there near the Furat, he was slaughtered and murdered. He was killed. No Shaheed have died or killed in that fashion. Tonight is the night of Ali Akbar, in which I would like to recite the Masaib of him in more detail. However, the night is the night of Masaib to talk about what really happened on the night of Ashura, how Imam Hussein was on the night of Ashura, how the women and children were preparing their loved ones in order that they go and sacrifice. Here it's been mentioned that in one of the riwayat of Ibn Taus in Lahuf, that when Hazrat Ali Akbar alayhi salam was attacked badly, he throws his hand in the neck of the horse. And the horse is usually a dedicated animal. He is very dedicated to the master. Whenever that rider places the hand in the neck of the horse will take back the rider to its place, back to the safe place. But here the tradition says that Ali Akbar alayhi salam's back was cut into pieces. There's a term that is used, irban irba, which means his back was badly attacked. So Ibn Taus investigates what really happened. And he comes to the understanding that when Ali Akbar alayhi salam places that hand in the neck of the horse, the blood of Ali Akbar alayhi salam goes into the eyes of the horse. And there was a man who takes the rein of the horse and he brings him in middle of the army. When they brought Ali Akbar alayhi salam in the middle of the army, they attacked from all sides on the back of Ali Akbar alayhi salam. And they were saying, "We will attack you more because your name is Ali." Because the animosity that they have for Ali. And as they attacked him on the back of Ali Akbar with the swords, with the spears, with the arrows, and finally Ali Akbar falls onto the ground and he gives his salams and salutations to his father and calls for aid and help. Imam Hussein, like a falcon, goes towards the prey, then the same fashion comes to Ali Akbar. When that dust settles, He places the head of Ali Akbar. A man is seen by the head in his lap, trying to speak to him, trying to clean the blood that he has on his face. But however, here we find the tradition that Imam is asking his son to hug the Imam with both hands. The son is hiding something that is stuck in his chest. And finally, when the father asks, "Oh Ali Akbar, put both the hands," and he takes the other hand by force and puts it on the neck, and for his realization, he sees the edge of that spear stuck in his heart. It wasn't easy for him. And the old father is trying to pull out this head of the spear. It is very difficult, as the reciters have recited, that he places his knee on the ground with all his strength. He pulls that spear by shouting, "Ya Ali." As he pulls it, there was a fountain of blood that comes on his face, and he looks at the heaven and he says, "This is how I will meet Rasulullah. This is how I will meet Allah, with the blood of Akbar, with the blood of the companions, and then with the blood of Asghar as well." And finally, when he starts to lament and cry, as Zainab sees the restlessness of her brother, the restlessness of the Imam of the time, she comes out of the tent, and the Rawi reports that, "I saw a tall lady coming out of the tent, lamenting and wailing." And finally she reaches Imam Hussein alayhi salam and places the hand on the shoulder of Imam Hussein, and she says, "Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raja'un." "My brother, may Allah accept your sacrifice. May Allah accept." She condoles, she gives that condolences, which gives that condolences, which brings that ease and peace to the heart of the Imam. And finally, it's been mentioned that the body of Ali Akbar was held by the children of Bani Hashim. Imam Hussein calls, "Oh little ones, come and help and aid this old man to take the body of his son in the tents." When the body of Ali Akbar was brought, the women and children started to lament, started to cry, started to do ma'atam, saying, "Wa Akbara, Wa Akbara, ala lanatullah ala qawm al-zalimeen, sayalamu al-ladhina zalwa yibun qalibin yanqalibun. اللهم وندوك باسمك العظيم العظيم الأجل الأكرم بعدد ما أحاط به علمك بمولانا أبا عبد الله الحسين عليه السلام. يا الله 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 يا رحمن يا رحيم يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلوبنا على دينك يا قاضي الحاجات يا كافي المهمات إنك على كل شيء قدير. رحم الله من قرأ الفاتحة لأرواح المؤمنين والمؤمنات, especially the marhumin of the brothers and sisters who are present here, with the loud salawat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.